Good morning. AJ, love you too, man. Good morning to everyone coming in. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. We serve an amazing God. Come on in. Somebody ought to begin to worship him even right now. God has been so good to us. If we had 10,000 tongues, it wouldn't be enough to give him the praise that he's truly worthy of. Good morning, Tracy. Good morning. Come on in. I have a message for us this morning. The things that we've been running from, no longer are we running. There are some things that we feared that we're getting ready to face. Praise God. No longer will I be tormented. I am more than a conqueror. Praise God. Good morning, Roberta. Good morning, Joe. Good morning. Good morning to everyone. Let's have a word of prayer. Father, we come to you this morning, and first and foremost, we just want to thank you. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your grace. Thank you, Lord, for favor this morning. Thank you for touching us and breathing into us the breath of life. Thank you for allowing us to be on top of the ground, as my friend would say, and not the ground on top of us. We pray for bereaving families this morning, God. We pray for the violence in our city. We pray, God, that you would have a ram in the bush. We pray, God, that you would stand up in the midst of a hurting people and that you would make yourself known among us. Father, we come to you today and we ask for forgiveness of sin. We know that we've all sinned and we've come short of your glory, God. We've missed the mark, and we miss that mark every single day. But Lord, I pray that you would give us the strength to keep pressing and running after you, that we would become God chasers, that we would also be mindful that you are the first and the last. You are the beginning and the end. You are the Alpha and the Omega. You are our healer. You are the balm in Gilead, God. You are everything that we need. And I pray that you would help us to look to the hills from which comes our help and understand that our help comes from the Lord. We need you, God. We need your presence. We need you. We need your spirit to dwell among us, God. We pray, God, that you would just have your way within your people, that you would use us, God, to be a light in a dark place. I pray that you would redirect us, that you would refocus us, God, that you would give us what we need, God, to be everything that you've called us to be. We know that we are not a perfect people. We understand that, but we are a people who's been perfected by you. And so we pray that you will continue to perfect us, God, and that you will continue to place us on the potter's wheel, and that you will remove those things that are detrimental to our future, God, that's detrimental to our kingdom assignment, that's detrimental to your kingdom agenda for us overall. And God, we lift you up, for we know that if you be lifted up, that you would draw all men unto you, God. Teach us to pray. Teach us to seek your face and not just what's in your hand. I pray for every struggling person this morning who's logged into this live. Let them know that they didn't come by this live by accident. You directed them here, God. They are here by your divine providence, and I pray that you would give them what they need. Allow your words to be life to them, God. I pray that you would energize them, God, and that you resuscitate their lives, God. Resuscitate us all. Give us what we need in this moment, and we'll be careful to give you all the praise. We know that the Son of Man came to seek and to save that which was lost. And so we pray that you would keep drawing people unto yourself. And we'll be careful to give you all the praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Good morning, good morning, good morning to everyone. You have your Bibles with you. I want you to turn with me to 1 Samuel 17. 1 Samuel 17. And we'll start reading in verse 48. 1 Samuel 17, verse 48. Our God is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we could ask or think, according to the power that works within us. 1 Samuel 17, 48. And this morning I want to talk about no more running. No more running. There are some things, many of us have been running from, and some people have been running for most of their life or most of their adulthood. And it's finally time to face those things that we have feared for so long. And I'm a firm believer that we cannot fix what we are not willing to face. There are some things that we need to go ahead and face. We need to stop running from our callings. We need to stop running from those old demons. We need to stop running from those family issues. We need to stop running, you know, from ourselves and our own realities. We need to just stop running. We need to stop running from God. We need to just stop running. And it's time for us to face those things that we need to face so that we give God the room to fix what we have been fearing. And so if you look in 1 Samuel 17:48, it's a familiar passage of scripture to most of us. We know about the story of David, Saul, and Goliath and the army of Israel. And many of us know some of the details that surround that story. But I believe this morning that God has given me a few extra points that I believe will be a blessing to those of you who need a word from the Lord. And so I need somebody to type this in. I'm done running. Just type it in. I'm done running. I am done running. I have been running for way too long, and I'm finally going to stop so that I can fix my issue. And I don't know what you're running from. I don't know what you're dealing with, but it's finally time to look it in the face and to deal with it, and to deal with it. Yes, it might hurt. Yes, it might be painful. Yes, it might break you down. Yes, it might, fear may arise within you, you know, but at least you can deal with it. You can look it in the face, and you can give yourself the opportunity to fix what you have been fearing for way too long. Some people won't go to the doctor because they fear a diagnosis. Some people know what they need to do, but just won't do it because they are so afraid of what the outcome is going to be. And so I want to remind you this morning that that power belongs to God. God has the ability to change whatever outcome you have. God has the power. God has the means. He has the sources. He has whatever it takes to make that outcome be whatever he wants it to be. And so there's no need to run any longer. It's time to face what we've been fearing. And so the text says, then it happened while the Philistines rose and came and drew near No, Goliath, David came near to meet. Let me just go back to the text. I got kind of crossed up. I'm in 1748. This is what it says. Then it happened when the Philistines rose and came and drew near to meet David, that David ran quickly toward the battle line to meet the Philistines. And so let's talk about the issue at hand. The first issue at hand is that many of us are still being defeated by some of the same demons that have been torturing us for years. And if you know anything about a demon will stay as long as you give it a place of occupancy. As long as you allow it to stay, as long as you allow it to taunt you, as long as you have a vacancy, a demon will always take up residence there. And so many of us have been trying to shake these demons, and we've been running. We've been all confused about what's going on in our lives, and it's finally time to slow down. I believe that sometimes people, they intentionally become busybodies because they don't want to slow down, because when you slow down, you have no choice but to think about your life. And so some people become busybodies because they don't want to face their own realities. And so it's time for us to slow down and to ask God, what is it that you want me to see? What is it that you want to do through me? What is it that you're trying to reveal to me in this moment? What is it, Lord, that you're trying to fix in me? Because I know that I am imperfect. I know that I have struggles. I have issues. I have my past that's trying to hunt me down, trying to chase me, Lord. And so I'm going to lean and depend on you. I'm going to trust you with whatever you're going to do in this season in my life so that I can become the best version of what you want me to be. And so it's time for us to stop running from these demons and to finally face them. As long as you run from a demon, it'll always chase you. So some of these demons we are wrestling are some of the same ones that no one in our families have overcome. Some of us are fighting drug demons. Some of us are fighting alcoholic demons. Some of us are fighting whoremonger demons. Some of us are fighting, the list of demonic activity is a very long list. I don't even think you can exhaust it. It's so much that we're running from. But a lot of this stuff is passed down from generation to generation. And instead of us facing it, a lot of times we do what our grandfathers did or what our fathers do or what our grandparents do. We run from it. And I believe that it's time for somebody to finally slow down and say, no longer will I allow these same demons that tore up my family in the past tear up my family right now. You know, you have to face those things, and you have to learn how to cast things down, and you have to learn how to put the word of God on it and start speaking against those things, because the power of God is available for all of those who tap into it. I think a lot of times we don't even realize the power that we possess as believers. You have the power to speak those things that are not as if they are. And you have the power of life and death in your tongue. So if alcoholism ran in your family, then it stands to reason that if you want to overcome that, that you have to start speaking against it. You have to start praying over your children and praying over your house and start declaring things out of your own mouth, you know, that you're not going to allow this to take over your family. You will not allow this to overcome your kids. You will not allow this to overcome your grandkids. So you just have to learn how to use the word of God for your benefit. That's why he gave us the word. We just need to learn how to wield our sword. And as a result of all of these demons trying to hunt us down, our prosperity and elevation has been stunted. And let's be quite honest this morning. Many of us know for sure that we are supposed to be way further ahead in life than we are. But guess what? We got so many things that we're running from, so many things that we won't fix, so many things that we won't face. And the result of it is that it has hindered our prosperity. It has stunted our elevation. God is always ready to elevate us and take us higher, but he cannot do that if you won't face and fix the things that have been trying to overtake your life. Our peace has been taken, and our power has been stripped away by the enemy simply because we keep running. Okay, so I want to talk about somebody in the text this morning, a man known by the name of Goliath. We've heard this story countless times, and we've heard so many preachers preach it differently. But I want to draw out some things today about this text. But first, let's talk about who Goliath is. Goliath was a Philistine warrior. He was a warrior. Fighting was in his nature. He was a warrior by nature. Not only was he a Philistine warrior, he was the head warrior. You know, when Goliath came, everybody had fear and trembling going on. Not only was he a warrior, but he single-handedly tortured and taunted everyone the Philistines fought. Everybody they fought were afraid because guess what? They had Goliath on their team. And to add to his strength, he was 9'9". Do you hear me? I've never looked at anybody who was 9'9". That's how tall Goliath was. And so his size alone was intimidating. Not only that, but he was also undefeated as a warrior. Nobody had ever beat Goliath. No one has ever overcome him. No one has ever made him bow. No one had ever made him yield. Nobody had ever made him tap out. Nobody was able to check Goliath. You know, Goliath would come through and he would say, "Who's checking me?" And there was nobody who could check him. He had the whole, and this is what gets me, is that he had the whole army of God afraid of him. Now, if you are a child of God, fear should never consume you. Let me say that one more time. If you are a child of God, fear should never consume you. What I am saying is that there will be moments where fear will arise. There will be moments when you will become fearful because it is human nature. But when fear defines you and when fear knocks you off the path that God has placed before you, that simply means that you don't trust God where he placed you. If God placed you where you are and in the position that you're in, you have to know that he already foreknew what would come your way. And if God placed you in that position to deal with it, to face it, to come face to face with it, then he knew that you had the strength to overcome it. But when you operate in fear, fear makes you forget about the power that you possess. And that's why many of us lose battles now. We lose battles because we stay in fear too long. And the longer you stay in fear, you give your opponent and the enemy time to reinforce. You give your enemy time to overcome you. You know, you have to always make sure that you are walking in faith. Most of what Jesus did in the New Testament, he did it because somebody had faith. And so when you operate in fear, it trumps your faith. And so some people say that they both can't exist in the same room, but they really do. You can't even acknowledge or realize fear without faith. And you can't realize faith without fear. They both work together, but you have to make sure that you're not allowing fear to trump your faith. Because when you begin to walk in faith, that's when doors begin to open. That's when God does his best work in your life. Because listen to me, faith is attractive. Faith is attractive to God. And wherever he finds faith, he begins to move in that arena. And so without faith, according to the scriptures, it is impossible to please God. And those who come to God must believe that he is and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. And so he had the whole army of God fearing him. Now, here come little David bringing food and water and checking on the welfare of his brothers, and he ends up launched into this battle. But there are several things that I want to share with you that stands out to me about David. David comes to the scene, and David comes to the rescue, somebody that they were totally not expecting to take on the responsibility that that he took upon himself to take. And so let's look at these things right here. I want you, somebody, to type them in as I give them to you. One, David had the courage to face what everybody else feared. David had the courage to face what everybody else feared. This is what makes you stand out as a child of God. When you are a child of God, you must be willing to face the things that other people are fearing. Because watch this, you possess a different type of power. You possess a different type of power, okay? And because you possess this power, it enables you to look at things and to deal with things and to face things head on that other people wouldn't even give themselves a chance to deal with, okay? And so it's not that you're cocky. It's not that that you have all of this self-confidence. Your confidence is not coming from you. Your confidence comes from the throne of grace. Okay, so David had the courage to face what everybody else was fearing. 1 Samuel 17:32 says this. It says, David said to Saul, "Let no man's heart fail on account of Goliath." And then he says, "Your servant will go and fight this Philistine." And so David was willing to put his life on the line. He was willing to sacrifice everything about him and everything that he had to protect the name of God. And so he was willing to do what nobody else was doing. You got a whole army of grown men that was there. David was still a young boy, but you got these grown men. And on top of that, you have King Saul, who was not willing to take Goliath on. And so let me pause for a moment and ask you a question. What is your Goliath? What's going on in your life that you're not willing to face? What are you running from? How long have you been running? And how much longer will you keep on running? Because if you don't face whatever it is that you're running from, I need you to know that it's not going to go away. It's not going to just disappear. I can remember as a young boy, and my church knows this because I've shared it with them before. They know this dude named William who used to chase me home off the school bus. You know, all he would say is, "I'm gonna get you" when the school bus stopped. And you better believe I was waiting on them air brakes to hit. And as soon as that door flung open, I hopped off that bus and I ran home as fast as I could. And I did that a couple of times. But one time I did that and my dad was at home. And when I got home, my dad was wondering why was I running in the house in such a panic. And I told him that William was chasing me, that William keep trying to fight me. And this one particular day, my dad made me wait on William. He made me wait on William because guess what? If my dad did not make me fight William, then William would have kept chasing me home every single day. And it was not until I was willing to fight William. And the reason I didn't want to fight is because I feared pain. I thought it hurt so much to fight or to get hit in the face and that it would kill you or something. I just didn't know what to think. But I realized that as my dad made me fight William, you know, and watch this, my strength came from the fact that my dad was there. Listen to what I'm saying. And that's where David's strength came from. He knew that the Lord was on his side. And because the Lord was on his side, he was able to face what everybody else was fearing. And so as I began to fight William, I realized for the first time in my life what adrenaline was. My adrenaline started kicking in, and I started swinging, and I'm sure William hit me a few times, and I hit him, you know, but when the fight was over, I felt nothing. I know he hit me, and I hit him, but I felt nothing because of the adrenaline, and because I knew that I wasn't going to die because my father was right there. And so here it is. I don't know what you're dealing with. I don't know what you're running from, but it's time to stop running and know that the Lord is on your side. And because he's on your side, then there is nothing. There is nothing in this realm that you cannot face. The Bible says that if the Lord be for you, that he's more than the world against you. And you got to understand that you are more than a conqueror through Christ Jesus, our Lord. And so if you're ever going to become a fierce warrior or victor, we have to be willing to take on tasks that most people are running from. You cannot just be, just blend in. You got to understand that you are distinct, that there is something unique about you. And a lot of times it is your uniqueness that God has placed in you that will deliver you from a lot of stuff. God, as a matter of fact, the Bible says your gifts will make room for you. You know, so you have to be authentically yourself, and you cannot be that when you are running from things that you need to be facing. And so David showed great courage. David showed great courage in the midst of an army and a leader whose heart was failing right in front of the enemy. And the last thing you ever want to do, and I need you to type this in, you don't ever want your enemies to see you sweat. You don't ever want to give your enemies the indication that they are winning. You don't ever want to show that side in front of your enemies because it makes them feel more victorious. And the more victorious they feel over your life, the more they will attack you, the more they will come for you. And just think about this. When Jesus was in the wilderness in Matthew chapter 4, the enemy came at him with three different temptations. And once he realized he could not get him then, the Bible says that Satan left and the angels came and began to minister to Jesus. So what I'm saying is that, yes, the enemy is going to come one time. He's going to come two times. He's going to come three times. But once he realizes that you are standing on the word of God and that you are trusting in the Lord and not in yourself, then he will flee for a season and God's angels will come and begin to minister to you. But the moment you show that fearful side is the moment that he says, I got him now. And so the last thing you want to do is to allow your enemies to see you sweat. So one, David had the courage to face what everybody else feared. Secondly, here it is. David knew that in order for him to at least have a chance, he had to have momentum. Somebody type in momentum. Momentum is important. If you watch sports, then you know that it is the momentum that changes the game. It is the momentum that changes the outcome. It is the momentum that gets the attention of others. It is the momentum that gives you the advantage, okay? And so if you look at verse 48, that is the text we took at the beginning of this message, the Bible says that David ran quickly toward Goliath. Okay? See, that is unheard of. David is running toward what everybody else is running from. Do you see the difference here? David had the audacity to run toward the problem while everybody else was so fearful that they would run from the problem, not understanding that if you run this year, you're going to have to run next year too. If you run today, you're going to have to run tomorrow. But if you face it today, then you can fix it today. Come on, somebody. If you hit it head on and give yourself the momentum, I'm not waiting on something to hit me. I'm not waiting for something to come running toward me. If I know it's a problem, then I'm going to give myself the advantage by having the momentum, and I'm going to attack the issue at hand. Okay? So you're talking 9'9", and you're talking about 5' something David. Okay? You know, so David understood that he needed momentum. David ran quickly toward Goliath in front of everyone who was running from him. And so here's your word right here. The thing that you have been running from, it's time for you to run toward it. And the sooner you start running toward it, you will give yourself the momentum you need to defeat it. But the longer you just stand there, it's going to keep on tormenting and taunting you. If you refuse to come at it, it will continue to come at you. Okay? So at some point, you have to be willing to deal with what's in your arena. You have to be willing to address whatever you need to address. There's no need to run from it because guess what? It ain't going nowhere. David knew that he had the strength of the Lord on his side. That's why he wrote in Psalms 28 verse 7, he says, "The Lord is my strength and my shield." Do you hear me? The Lord is my strength and the Lord is my shield. And then he goes on to say, "My heart trusts in him and he helps me." Lord have mercy. "My heart leaps for joy, and with my song I praise him." Let me just say what David said again. This is what he penned. The Lord is my strength. And so what he's saying in so many words, that I'll never run out of strength because I'm not operating in human strength. When I operate in human strength, I always seem to fall short. But when I operate in God's strength, he gives me enough strength to complete whatever task I am taking on. And so not only is God his strength, but he said that God is his shield. What is a shield? A shield stops you from getting hit. A shield is what you use to deflect the fiery arrows and darts that the enemy is throwing at you. So while you are in full strength and you are in a position to win, God is also protecting you from the things that will come your way. Okay, the things that will take your strength, the things that will weaken you, the things that will try to level you to the ground. And so God is not only your strength, but he's your shield. And because of that, your heart can trust him. When somebody is your strength and when somebody is your shield, then you know you can trust them. They're giving you strength when you need it and protection when you need it. And so they are trustworthy. So David is saying in so many words that I trust him. And I want you to type that in right now. I trust him. I trust God. I trust him. Even though I can't trace him sometimes, I trust him. I trust him in this moment. I trust him in this season. Although I'm confused about where I am in life, I trust that God is going to bring this thing to fruition. He's going to give me the revelation that I need to see where I'm going, to see what I need to do, to put myself in position to be a recipient of what God is giving us from heaven. Okay? So whatever problems you have this morning, it's time to hit it head on. Why? Because if you don't, it will stand there and it'll be right there tomorrow and it'll be there the next day and the next day and the next day, and you'll only be wishing and hoping that it goes away. But here's the news, it's not going anywhere until you hit it head on. And so David knew that in order for him to at least have a chance, he had to have momentum. Thirdly, David didn't let someone dress him for a war they wouldn't fight. You got to stop letting people dress you for stuff they ain't willing to face. They ain't willing to fight. So in verse 38, I want you to look back up. I'm in 1 Samuel 17. If you look in verse 38, it says that, 38 right here. It says, "Then Saul clothed David with his garment and put a bronze helmet on his head. And he clothed him with armor." So listen, Saul is the king of Israel. Saul was afraid to fight the battle. So he took his stuff off and he placed his stuff on David. Okay? But I need you to understand that your stuff don't fit me. Your stuff don't fit me. It might work for you, but just because you put it on and it worked for you, don't mean you can put it on me and it worked for me. Okay? Because armor was usually tailor-made for the person that's wearing it. Hello, somebody. And so my next thought is this. How does Saul even know that his armor will work if he ain't willing to go to war in it. And so you're going to take your stuff off that's used to protect you because you're afraid to take on the challenge in front of the whole army of God. And you're going to put your stuff on me and want me to fight a battle that you wouldn't fight in it. If you don't trust your armor, why should I trust it? And so, Lord have mercy. Listen to this. Don't ever let somebody else's stuff become your baggage. Ooh-wee. Type that in. Don't ever let somebody else's stuff become your baggage, because if it's for them to wear, then it'll never fit you. Many people are bogged down today because they are wearing other people's problems. They are wearing other people's pain. They are wearing other people's past. You can't even live your life because you're wearing other people's stuff. Today is the day that you take that stuff off. Strip it off of you and get light for the flight. Take that stuff off of you so that you can be the best version of yourself that God wants you to be. You can't do that if you got on other folks' stuff. If I put your armor on me, it becomes baggage to me. It was protection for you, but it was baggage for me. Let me say that again. If I put your armor on me, your armor is protection for you, but it becomes baggage to me. And it becomes baggage because it don't fit me. It was never designed to go on me. Okay? And so, furthermore, you never want someone to dress you for a battle they won't fight, that they won't fight for real. You know what I'm saying? Like, how you going to dress me to go to war when you standing there and have stood there for many years watching Goliath taunt the army of God? And listen, there's no reason nobody will fight Goliath, because the leader was a cowering down to Goliath. And so if a leader won't fight, then more than likely the people ain't going to fight. If you got a fierce leader that's not afraid to hit things head on, then usually the type of people that will follow that leader are people who will fight too. But if you got a coward as a leader and they cower down in front of everybody every day, every year, every month, every second, then the only people that's going to follow that coward is other cowards. And so in this particular, listen, Saul was anointed, but he was a coward in this instance. And a little young shepherd boy who had been out there keeping sheep, not even being acknowledged by other people, came to the rescue. And what's so crazy about this, David was anointed the king of Israel 17 years before he actually became the king of Israel. He had been anointed for 17 years. And after Samuel anointed him, David went back to serving. David went back to keeping sheep. David went back and waited till it was his time to shine. People today, they want to shine immediately. They don't want to work in the fields. They don't want to do nothing behind the scene. They always want recognition, always want to be in front of the news, always want to be the talk of the town, always want to be first. You know, but they don't want to put in any work. But David wasn't like that. Even though he was anointed, he was still a servant. Today, people get anointed and think everybody's supposed to serve them. David was anointed and still went back to serving. And he wasn't like Joseph. He didn't talk about his anointing. He just did what he needed to do. Listen, this is why you got to be careful who you let dress you. Saul's heart was exposed after David beat Goliath. Saul's heart was exposed. See, a lot of people's hearts aren't revealed to you until after you win. As long as you're losing, everybody is going to stay silent. Everybody's going to stay in pocket. everybody's going to stay at a distance. But the moment you start winning, will reveal the hearts of the people around you. This is why David says that he prepares a table before you in the presence of your enemies. They've always been around, but you didn't know who they were until God blessed your table. And so here it is, Saul's heart being exposed after David won, which in my opinion, he never thought or wanted David to win in the first place. Which is why I believe that he put armor on David that David couldn't fit, because he wanted baggage to hold him back. Because Saul was wise enough to know that if David defeated Goliath, then the talk of the town would not be about Saul, but it would be about David. And so David, I believe that Saul was comfortable with Goliath winning every year. If he could have defeated Goliath, it would have been a whole different story. But if somebody else had to defeat Goliath, then he would rather for Goliath to keep winning. Because if somebody else does it, then it's going to give them a reputation for being a real warrior. And watch this. Not only this, but some people might not even recognize this in the scriptures, but Saul promised a reward for whoever defeated Goliath. He promised a reward for whoever defeated Goliath. And one of those rewards that he promised was his daughter. He promised that whatever man defeats Goliath, I will give them my daughter. And there was another list of things that he promised to give. But guess what? After David defeated Goliath, Saul never gave him his daughter. He gave his daughter to another man. And so if you look at 1 Samuel chapter 18, verse 9, Saul looked at David with suspicion from that day forward. The moment he won, he became a suspect to the king. And so once again, David didn't let someone dress him for a war they wouldn't fight. And this is my last point right here. David stayed focused on the target. David stayed focused on the target and hit it the first time. David stayed focused on the target and he hit the target the first time. Lord have mercy. Listen, a focused person is a winning person. Somebody type that in. A focused person is a winning person. If you let people steal your focus, then you'll stop winning. But if you stay locked in to your purpose, if you stay locked in to your calling, if you stay connected to your kingdom assignment, and you don't lose focus, then you are guaranteed to win. You are guaranteed to win. You need to get people out of your life that has proven to be a distraction. You need to get them proven distractions out of your life. Because as long as they are in your life, it's going to be hard to win, because they have you focused on stuff that have absolutely nothing to do with what God wants to do in your life. They're keeping you up on the latest drama. They all in other people's business, screenshotting everybody else's posts and pictures, trying to figure out somebody else's life. That is not a focused person. That is a losing person. Because a person that's winning is doing something to win. You can't be winning and all in somebody else's business and somebody else's life. You losing. And that's why you're miserable. Misery loves company. And so if you are a winning person, then that means that you need to surround yourself with winning people. It's not that you don't reach and help people up, but your circle cannot consist of everybody that's failing and losing. Some people still haven't learned. The reason you're living from check to check, and the reason you are operating outside of your purpose, and the reason that your mind is all over the place is because you are unfocused. You're worried about everybody else's business and everybody else's purpose, and you don't even realize what yours is. You still worrying about who's dating who and who's sleeping with who and who went here and who went there and who's going here and how much they make and where they move to. You still caught up on stuff that people been doing for years. And that's why you can't close on a home. And that's why you can't buy a car from a car lot, because you won't fix the things that you need to fix. You're worried about somebody else's issues and somebody else's problem. They over here happy. Let them be happy and find your happy place. But your happy place can never be in somebody else's business. You will never win that way. I know I just walked a little heavy. But it's the truth. David stayed focused on the target and he hit it the first time. Many people are losing the same battles the same way because they don't learn from losing. Man, who wants to be a loser? Nobody in their right mind wants to be defined as a loser. If you keep on losing, it's because you keep doing the same thing the same way every time. If you always think the same way, you're going to always get the same results. So at some point, you got to surround yourself with somebody who can instill something in you, who can help build certain principles in your life and teach you things, but you got to be willing to listen. You ought to be sick and tired of going through the motions. If you're approaching 40 years old and you still don't know what your purpose is, something ain't right about that. And if you're 45 and you still trying to rap, man, come on. Come on now. Your children need to eat. They got school fees need to be paid. And you up in a studio somewhere and your name ain't even out there. I can see if your name is popping and you out there and you got some residual income coming in. You know, you keep pushing for your dream. But if you 45 and you just decide that I'm a rap, I think I want to rap. And you 45 years old, dude, you half dead. Half your life is over. And so whatever your purpose is, you need to lock in on it, stay focused, and all the stuff that you're running from needs to be dealt with. Because if you don't face it, what if you found your purpose and you begin to walk in it and stuff that you refuse to face hunt you down? It's going to hinder those moments you should be celebrating, and you're going to be fighting something from your past. David didn't have a problem the reason David didn't have a problem winning in front of the crowd is because he was used to winning behind the scenes. A person that's losing behind the scenes is a person that will lose in the public's view, okay, in front of the crowd. David was used to winning behind the scenes when nobody was looking, because the Lord was his shepherd. He wasn't trying to impress people. He wasn't trying to impress the crowd. He didn't just have a certain type of energy to come up on his life because the crowd was looking. You know, some people are crowd pleasers. They don't do nothing behind the scene. But when a crowd show up, then boom, all this magic just begins to happen for them. But behind the scenes, they're losers. But not David. David was a winner behind the scene. Just how he looked out for the sheep that he was responsible for, he looked out for the people of God the same way. He knew that the Lord was his mighty shepherd and protector. If you're ever going to overcome what has been defeating you for most of your life, brothers and sisters, you have to stop running from it. You have to stop running from it. At some point, you have to face it so that you can fix it. Okay? If you run another year, you're going to prolong the process another year. And so I want to close with a few questions. One, what are you running from? What are you running from? You need to ask yourself that question. What am I running from? The second question you need to ask yourself, when am I going to stop running? When am I going to stop running? When am I going to build up the courage and the strength to face this thing I've been running from? Thirdly, what is your strategy for winning? If you're going to win, it's going to take strategy. It's going to take strategy. And the strategy has to consist of more than you. God has shown me that. That if you're going to win, it's going to take strategy. And you can't be the only strategizer. Fourthly, will you trust God even when you cannot trace him in the moment? Will you trust God even when you can't trace him in the moment? Are you trying to cover up and hide your real flaws? When you look in the mirror, are you trying to downplay your real issues? A person who cannot look themselves in the mirror and call it what it is a person that's headed for destruction. If you cannot look in the mirror and say, I smoke too much weed, or I get high too much, or I fornicate too much, or I do this too much, or I lie too much, or I'm in people's business too much. If you can't, regardless of what the issue is, whatever it is, when you look in the mirror, we ain't talking about what other people see. We're not worried about what nobody else is saying. It's about what you are willing to admit. When you look in the mirror and look at yourself, what do you see? What do you see? And will you trust God in the moment when you cannot trace him? No more running. I'm done running. I'm not running from my issues. I'm not running from my past. I'm not running from the truth. I'm not running from nothing. Because the sooner I focus in and face it, then guess what? I can fix it. All things are possible with our God. Nothing is too hard for him. If you need power and you need strength, you can get that today, because power is available through the one and only Jesus Christ. He says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. If you don't know him today as personal Lord and Savior, listen. The Bible says, whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. That's one thing I love about God. He'll always let you come home. He'll always let you come home. You may have backslidden. You may have set your Bible down. You haven't read it in a while. You may have just kind of turned away from your relationship with God altogether. I need you to understand, no matter where you've been, what you've done, there's room for you at the cross. There's room for you at the cross. I don't care who you are. It doesn't matter who you are. There's room at the cross for you. That's why Jesus died. He died to pave the way for you. He died to cover your sins. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But guess what? He paid it all. He paid it all. If you come to Jesus today, you're debt free. You're debt free. Why? Because he paid it all. He paid it all for you. He paid it all. And I don't know anybody in this world who don't need Jesus. I don't know anybody in this world. They may not realize they need him, but we know you need him. He says, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. And no man comes to the Father but by me. And so come to Jesus while you have time. There's a fountain filled with blood flowing from Emmanuel's veins. And when sinners plunge beneath that flood, they lose all their guilt and stain. At the cross where I first saw the light and the burdens of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. This joy that I have, the world didn't give it to me, and the world cannot take it away. Listen, if you want to experience real joy, then you got to get to know Jesus. It's not that you won't have issues. It's not that you won't go through painful experiences in life. But those experiences will not define who you are. You will always rise above your worst situation because this joy you have, it comes from the Lord. And the joy that he gives, the world cannot take it away from you. The only way they can have your joy is if you give it to them. And so, don't give up on people. Don't give up on them. There are so many people that I believe that God is going to flood the church house again. And even through all that we've been through and all that we've experienced, a lot of hurt people, a lot of people that are damaged, we still haven't even felt the true repercussions of the pandemic. That is still stuff that haven't hit yet. You know, so we're going to need God. We're going to need him. We're going to need him. And so let me pray for you. First, I want to pray with you, and then we're going to give you the opportunity to give. Father, we come to you, and we thank you for every person who's come into the kingdom. We thank you for the privilege of prayer. We thank you for this message that gives us the hope of facing what we need to fix. We give you honor, praise, and glory for your presence and your power, your anointing, God. We thank you, Lord, for just allowing us one more time to get this thing right, get it together. We give you praise, honor, glory, because power, dominion, and authority belongs to you. We thank you, Lord, for being a prayer answering God. You are a healer. You are everything that we need, and we give you honor. We praise you. We lift you up. We magnify you. We adore you, God, for who you are. We pray right now, God, for every person who's struggling with facing their fear. Finally, God, finally, today, they'll be able to go back to that place that they've been running from, and they'll be able to do what they need to do to fix the problem. That person who knows they need to go to the doctor and get some help. That person who knows they need to stop running from their family issues. That person who knows that they need to finally go home and deal with the problem, even if it hurts. Even if it hurts, it's better to be dealt with and faced than to spend the rest of our lives running from it. And so we thank you for the grace that you're going to give us to deal with these things. And we thank you for your mercy that covers us while we do it. Lord, we love you. And we give you praise, honor, and glory. We pray for those who just come into the kingdom, those who have asked you to come into their hearts that they might be saved. We praise you for that. We know the angels in heaven are rejoicing right now over one sinner coming into the family, coming into the fold. We ask this in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. I want to give you the opportunity to give also. If you want to give, you can give three different ways. You can cash app Inner Peace Church. Or you can go to our website, which is www.innerpeacechurch.org. Or you can text GIVE to 423-301-5545. And you can also please follow us on all of our platforms. We have YouTube, we have IG, we have Facebook, and we have Twitter. And so when you get a chance, please follow us. And if you want to mail anything to us, you can do that at P.O. Box 22402. And the zip code is 37422, 37422. And we want to thank all of you for just being a part of what God is doing through us. We praise God for you, and we pray that you are being blessed in the process. If our ministry has been a blessing to you, just please let us know. Let us know what we're doing right. Because we are working on some things, we're working on changing up some stuff, but we want to make sure that our messages and our ministry is a blessing to our community. And so once again, we love you. You all know how to reach us if you want to reach us, and we will contact you back. We love you. We praise God for you. Now may the grace of God and the sweet abiding communion of the Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide with each of us now, henceforth, and forevermore. Amen. God bless you all. Please share the video. Please share the video. We want to get the word out to as many people as possible. Thank you. Talk to you soon. Bye.